Hi, everyone, and welcome to I Rebel on the Voluntary Virtues Network. Thanks for joining us this morning. I'm Sarah, and I'm here with Meredith. Hi, Meredith.
Hi, Sarah.
Today, we're going to dig into a topic that's near and dear to my heart, peaceful parenting and unschooling, or sometimes also known as unconditional parenting or partnership parenting or life learning. Meredith and I would like to discuss how we feel this approach to parenting fits in line with voluntaryism or libertarianism so much that we could even hypothesize that anyone that feels strongly about peaceful parenting might be a voluntaryist and not even know it. And on the flip side of that, I would also say that if you are a parent and a voluntaryist, it would probably be of interest to you to explore the very voluntaryist ideas behind peaceful parenting. So just what is peaceful parenting? And peaceful parenting is using intentional, gentle ways to guide children, using empathetic and cooperative solutions versus trying to control their behavior with bribes, yelling, and punishments. It involves working with children by listening, understanding, responding, and communicating with intention. I also wanted to share a very interesting point that Pam Sarushian made in an article on the Natural Child Project. She's a veteran unschooler, peaceful parenting advocate, and she has grown unschoolers. And so she's been talking about the subject for a long time. And one of the points in an article titled How to Unschool, she wrote, "Think about what is really important and keep that always in the forefront of your interactions with your children. What values do you hope to pass on to them? You can't pass on something you don't exemplify yourself. Treat them the way you want them to treat others. Do you want respect? Be respectful. Do you want responsibility from them? Be responsible. Think of how you look to them from their perspective. Do you order them around? Is that respectful? Do you say, I'll just be a minute and then take 20 more minutes talking to a friend while the children wait? Is that responsible? Focus more on your own behavior than on theirs. It's a bigger payoff." And Meredith and I came across a blog post that was speaking about the link of libertarianism or voluntarism and unschooling.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is a dissenting opinion from ours. So we kind of just wanted to read that. And I can see how somebody could have this opinion, but I totally disagree. I think it's a misunderstanding. So I'm going to read that, and then we'll talk about it. And this is from a blog called What to Tell the Neighbors, which is a great title. And it's by a woman named Suzanne Lamb. And it's titled Reasons Matter, Homeschooling, Unschooling, and Priorities. Homeschoolers come to homeschooling for different reasons. I get that. But I do think some reasons for homeschooling are better than others. It is better to homeschool because one cares about children's well-being than because one wants to exercise certain parental rights. It's better to homeschool because one wants to help specific children learn well and happily than because one wants to give the government the middle finger or to make some other kind of political statement. It's better to homeschool because one wants to make a child's world larger with more opportunities than because one wants to make it smaller with fewer opportunities. John Holt, the former teacher and founder of Growing Without Schooling magazine and the first to use the term unschooling, was a great friend of children. I think it's safe to assume that Holt would be disturbed by the attempts of the Homeschool Legal Defense Association to become the voice for all American homeschoolers. The HSLDA argues for the right of parents to use corporal punishment on their children and takes political stances on subjects like gay marriage that have nothing to do with homeschooling and everything to do with religion. The HSLDA has undermined decades of work by state-level homeschooling groups to secure reasonable homeschooling statutes, and the organization uses hyperbolic and distorted reports to scare parents into becoming dues-paying members in exchange for legal defense they don't need. Michelle Goldberg's Homeschooled Kids Now Grown blog against the past reveals much that is wrong with Christian fundamentalist homeschooling and with the HSLDA. The article makes it clear that many fundamentalist homeschooling parents are not only harming their children, but actually making the legal right to homeschool shakier for everyone. The general public is rightfully concerned about homeschooling that involves abuse, neglect, sexism, and anti-intellectualism. That is, with homeschooling used to make a child's world smaller instead of larger. Another threat to homeschooling, and unschooling in particular, comes from a different place on the political spectrum. Certain unschoolers, who see unschooling as inseparable from a libertarian or anarchist worldview, are actively courting media attention these days in the name of bringing unschooling to the mainstream. As with the HSLDA, both economic and political motives seem to be at work here. Unfortunately, some of these advocates seem to think that any attention is good attention. They imagine that the portrayals of unschooling on shows such as Wife Swap are wonderful, even if the privacy of their own children is violated by camera crews and their children's reputation damaged by unscrupulous editing. No matter what the media-seeking unschooling advocates say their intentions are, if the public is left with the impression that unschooling means children being left to fend for themselves in the name of liberty, the legal right to unschool will be jeopardized. The kinds of media representations that are good for unschooling, and there have been some of these, though never on Wife Swap, look deeply at how people learn and are thoughtful and nuanced in their discussion of how parents partner with their children. They are designed to be informational and not entertaining, which is to say, they don't include guests uttering bleeped out words and ranting at each other, and generally don't offer financial compensation to the participants. While I am glad to know some wonderful homeschooling families, I don't see myself as part of the homeschooling community or the unschooling community. I am wary of homeschooling where the priority is not helping children thrive, and of homeschooling and unschooling advocates with political and economic agendas that can too easily eclipse actual children's needs. So that's the end of the blog. So we just we wanted to touch on a couple things here. So when she's talking about Wife Swap, I don't know, some people might be familiar with this, some may not be. She's specifically talking about Dana Martin. I think it's kind of disingenuous or rude to not actually mention Dana Martin's name. She's the only unschooler that's been on Wife Swap. And if you haven't seen the show, it's fantastic. I loved it. Check it out. They pitted Dana Martin up against a very authoritarian mother, and Dana Martin came out with flying colors. She did fantastic. And I have a problem with the blog saying that Dana Martin has a political agenda, because at no point in that show. And generally, Dana Martin does not talk about politics. But at no point in the show did she mention liberty or anarchism or even libertarianism. She just went about her daily life, in the way that it's a reality TV show. So, right, and she did great.
She did.
Yeah, it was very informative. And I also have a problem with her. The blog post that is saying that there is something wrong with that particular medium. Why does she get to say what we should be looking at? Why does she get to say what's going to influence people and what isn't? I would say Wife Swap, that reaches lots and lots of people, is far and is also an empirical case. You can actually see this playing out on your TV right in front of you. So instead of going and seeking out a book talking about it, not that books are bad, there are plenty that talk about it, but on Wife Swap you actually got to see the interaction. You got to see how Dana Martin uses unschooling in her daily life and home, and you also got to see the extreme difference in the children. When this philosophy was applied. Even, I mean, it's sort of heartbreaking. It was heartbreaking to watch the children who were raised in this authoritarian home react. I mean, they cried. They thought this was a breath of fresh air. They got to express themselves, and they really, for once in their life, saw what it was like in a different paradigm of parenting, and they appreciated it. So
exactly.
Yeah, I think it's really rude to put that down. And to insinuate that people who are either fundamentalist Christians or anarchists are raising their kids in an unschooling paradigm because of their agendas outside of their children is awful. I just can't see that being true. Even if you are, I mean, we're voluntarists, and it is sort of inseparable. This is our worldview when it comes to children and everything else. But that's because we care. It's because we care about our children. It's because we care about the world. So,
that's right. That's right. And it's also living your values, which was to the point of that very profound point in how to unschool. I mean, it isn't separate. It's not like you can just separate it.
Yeah.
It's like a natural journey to it. Which, you know, one of the reasons that this subject is important to me is that I came to the ideas of voluntaryism through my decision to parent differently, which ultimately led me to the ideas of unschooling or life learning. I just applied my parenting and educational philosophy to my worldview and discovered the non-aggression principle and property rights. And I think of parenting in a partnership, it's a powerful example to children of how to live our principles. That, you know, if you were coming from the other direction where you're already accepting libertarianism and voluntaryism and property rights and the non-aggression principle, they just go back and forth. There's not a separation there.
Yes. And I would I would guess, I mean, I'm not, I don't know, just knowing people, the woman who wrote this blog post, her worldview is not separate from raising her children.
Exactly.
It's impossible. That's you can't just separate out, okay, I'm going to unschool my children but then be an extreme authoritarian in the rest of my life.
Right.
Doesn't quite make sense.
No. Yeah, and if we simply parent in the traditional top-down with punishments and rewards, we chip away at our children's ability to make their own decisions and explore their own wants and needs.
Mm-hmm.
And talking about the, you know, punishing the authoritarian, living an authoritarian life versus punishments, you know, they do work if the desired result is an unquestioning compliance. But how could you balance that out with living one way educationally and then parenting a different way completely? I think they go hand in hand.
Yes, definitely. They do. It's impossible to separate them. So I see her just being angry that some people think in a different way than she does. Mm-hmm. And I really think it's a misunderstanding more than anything. Understand the philosophy of voluntarism, so she's
right.
She's bashing it. But I really think it's just kind of shady to to bash Dana Martin, especially because she didn't use her name. That's rude.
Right. Exactly.
I don't hate that.
Exactly.
But if you've seen that particular wife swap, and I don't watch wife swap, that's the only time I've ever watched it because it was great. It's perfect. It's a you can see through that show the extreme difference, and doesn't even take that long to change the minds and worldviews of people when you're kind, when you apply voluntarist principles, when you give children choices, when you respect them as people.
That's right.
Turns them around.
It does. The way children learn to make good decisions is by making decisions, not mm-hmm. simply following directions. It's a simple yet profound concept.
Yes.
With freedom comes responsibility, and part of responsibility to freedom is the ability to assess risk. I think that children that are given a say in the decisions that affect them have a much better chance of arriving at adulthood with the skills to handle the responsibility of freedom.
Yes. And this woman's concerned about freedom. Mm-hmm. She's concerned about the freedom that she has. And so if she's concerned about freedom, well, maybe she should look toward what's making her unfree instead of getting mad at people who are advocates of freedom for all.
That's right. I agree. I just wanted to add that, just reiterate that home education goes hand in hand with the ideas of peaceful parenting and voluntaryism. Being in the world and facilitating experiences that your children are deeply interested in, or just exposing your children to the real world by living and learning side by side. As a peaceful parent and a home educator, you can foster completely respectful partnership with your child and help them navigate the world. There will be bumps and they may need you, but you can be there. There may be natural consequences that your child will experience and learn from, but you can be there to navigate those as well. And I wanted to hit on a really important point that I think people, when it comes to natural consequences, I think people can misunderstand natural consequences in the same way that sometimes people misunderstand natural rights.
Yes.
So with peaceful parenting, trust is really paramount. Our children need to trust that we have their best interests at heart and want to help them just as we would help any other important person in our life. So, for example, if I saw my child's skateboard on the driveway behind my husband's car, I could foresee the skateboard getting run over, and letting that happen is not what I'm referring to with a natural consequence. That would not be a natural consequence. And that would, I think, foster a real sense of mistrust with your kids.
Yes, that's sort of like you can see how the skateboard might get run over if the person leaving the driveway does not see the skateboard, but you don't actively run it over because it might happen. That's not a natural consequence. That's the parents.
Yes, punishing. Exactly. So I know that, I expressed my journey here through my parenting and my educational choices for my children. And you had did you have a similar experience?
I did. I also came to voluntarism through peaceful parenting. So this is sort of the opposite of what the blog is saying, is that you are a voluntarist, and then because you're a voluntarist, you do peaceful parenting. But you and I both had the opposite. We came to peaceful parenting first, and through learning all about that, we applied it to the rest of our lives and realized we were voluntarists. So that's quite different. Mm-hmm. And it starts from a place of caring. And I did want to give a story, not exactly the story about how I came to it, but this is an interesting sort of highlight of the difference it can make in the world. Mm-hmm. So I started, I really sort of adhered to the peaceful parenting philosophy when my daughter was around 9 or 10. Before that, I was authoritarian just like everybody else.
Yeah,
so, and it made a big difference. And it's since I've been peaceful parenting, my home is just so much more in harmony. We hardly ever fight. We treat each other with respect. My daughter comes to me with anything that she feels she wants to talk about, which is different than before. She's not afraid. She does have lingering effects from the way I was raising her previously in an authoritarian way. And you can see this, and we both know this, so we talk about it. But for instance, when I'm we're talking about her room, and she's a teenager, and she does not want to clean her. Actually, she wants a clean room, but she has a hard time finding the motivation to clean the room. So what happens is I say something like, don't you think your life would be easier if your room were clean? Because it's true. And don't you want to be able to have your clothes organized so you can wear what you want? Don't you want to be able to express your art? She's big into art. She does lots of drawings and artworks. And you can't quite see it if it's just thrown in among the rest of the mess. So there are real reasons that she knows that she wants her room clean, but because of her authoritarian upbringing, what's happened is that if I ask, just ask, she won't do it. She'll tell me I want to do it myself, which I respect, but then she does not do it herself. So she feels this, that she wants to have the clean room and she wants to do it herself. Yet when it comes time to get motivated to do it, she has a hard time with that. So what ends up happening is I let a couple months go by and then I get angry. So we have these back and forth, and then finally I yell, which I'm not proud of, but I'm a human, so it happens, and I will yell at her, and every time I yell at her, then she cleans it right away, or she lets me help her because she doesn't even want to do that. But every time I yell. So, and I've heard these similar stories before. The problem is because of the way that I raised her in the beginning, she's habituated to only reacting when I get upset, when she's getting in trouble. So if I take that punishment sort of paradigm out of it, she's lost the main motivator for her.
She hasn't developed the intrinsic motivation,
right,
or the ability to recognize that and leap with that.
Right.
Making the movement forward.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I mean, yelling at her really motivates her right away, which is sad. And we're working on it. And when that happens, I talk to her about it. She knows consciously that that's what's happening, and she's working on changing it. But it's, you know, changing habits in your brain, that takes a while. Mm-hmm. And so this is a real world example of what can happen if you raise your child in an authoritarian paradigm versus a voluntarist paradigm. And it's a great big difference.
It sort of rewires them from the beginning. But, you know, you're in partnership with her now, and, you know, you and your child are developing the skills for a working with rather than doing to. And so I think that's a really important thing too, to understand, like, this is as much a journey for the parents as the children. I'm learning so much about so many life skills that I didn't learn because I was raised in an authoritarian paradigm too. So I'm sort of rewiring my own thinking about things and applying real voluntaryist ideas to my everyday life, which feels really good to do, you know, and to see how that plays out just in your micro world, not, you know, and it also affects the bigger world too, but, you know, it's as much of the journey for both of us, for all of us, the kids and the parents.
Yes, and actually I just told her that the other day. We had a conversation about that, about how when you first start homeschooling, and the way people view it as well, is that you're going to be the teacher and they're going to be the student. But what ends up happening, especially in the unschooling paradigm, the peaceful parenting unschooling kind of thing, is that you both become students, and you're learning life, you're navigating and learning life together. And yes, I've grown immensely and learned so many more things since I've been doing this. And I don't know that I would have learned this stuff otherwise. In fact, a lot of the stuff I totally wouldn't have learned. It would have just been foreign to me. So we both enjoy that aspect of it. I am not her teacher, or I guess you could say we are each other's teachers.
Yes, I love that.
Mm-hmm. And it's clear. You don't even have to say it. That's just what happens. Is that let's learn this now.
Right. So I do want to add that none of this is a do this and produce that equation or a magic template for any outcome in particular. But it's about the journey with your children, which is what we're discussing. And I'm learning so many new things about life, relationships, and the world right along with my children. And I will say that parenting got so much easier, or just being a parent, being a person in this household with my children, when we found a groove in this new paradigm. And I think for a couple of reasons. One, the state was no longer involved in our relationship every day. There wasn't the overreach, the hand reaching into my home to, you know, litmus test if I'm the good parent or the bad parent that returns the homework and all the signed papers. All of that stuff was just lifted away immediately and took a huge amount of stress out of the whole thing. You know, and they weren't spending time with strangers 7 hours a day and then coming home and trying to adjust all the unmet needs from a long day at school, and just simply dropping the control aspect of our relationship with each other, beginning the work on a partnership, just felt really right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think sort of the whole point of being both a peaceful parenting advocate and a voluntarist is so you take that what's happening in your life, and I've had a similar experience. Our days are smooth. We hardly ever fight. We used to fight all the time, but yeah, a huge stressor is gone. And not just that, you get into a rhythm, you get to know your child, they get to know you, and their expectations actually rise naturally because they are then a contributor to your home or to their home as much as you are. So, and they understand that. But taking that sort of working model and looking at it in the perspective of the rest of the world or interactions between adults, interactions in daily life, really has a powerful potential to change our whole world. And when we're talking about this has made our home peaceful, well, if this is applied to the rest of the world, why wouldn't it make the rest of the world peaceful? And isn't this something that we want as a species? Everybody's talking
exactly.
About, you know, it just seems to follow naturally from that. When you respect other people, when you respect their autonomy, when you respect their choices, when you're not trying to force your opinions and your beliefs onto them, when you their expectation in the world goes up, the sort of what you were talking about, natural responsibility, it just happens. It just comes into the picture. You realize that that's what's going on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's completely easy to understand how this all fits the voluntaryist philosophy. You know, we know people, it's desirable for people to feel control over their lives and to learn the skills how to have the responsibility that brings.
Yes. Yeah, because it does take some learning.
It does.
You can't flip a switch overnight and have it happen. I mean, even in my home, we've been doing this for years, and just like I was talking about, there are still residual effects of authoritarian parenting that we're working through. So.
Yeah. Well, I think we're I think we're about out of time.
Yep, it looks like it. Yeah, so we just wanted to say thanks for listening. And you can catch us every Saturday morning on the Voluntary Virtues Network. We're here talking about whatever we want to talk about. And so we'll see you next week. Thank you, Sarah.
Thank you, Meredith. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.